Praise the Lord. I welcome every one of you to the Bible study tonight in Jesus' name. And I pray that the Lord will enrich your life as we study the Word of God together. You rise up as we pray together. Father, we thank you for our Bible study. Thank you for your love and thank you for the revelation of your Word. Thank you because every time you come, you grant us the teaching spirit, the Holy Ghost, who inspired the Word to explain, to apply, to expound the Word unto us. I will pray that tonight the Holy Spirit will take this Word and apply it to every heart in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, as we study the Word, we'll be the stronger for it. We'll be the wiser for it. I will pray, Lord, that you'll so help us that our strength and might will work in every life. That as we receive the Word and believe the Word, this Word will work mightily in every one of us. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. We're studying from Hebrews chapter 11. We've been on this now for a few weeks. And tonight we're looking at verses 13, 14, 15, and 16. Look at your Bible. In Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country, and truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is an heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. As we look at this chapter 11 of Hebrews, you'll find that the chapter itself majors on faith. From the earliest part, you see it says now, faith is the substance of things so forth and the evidence of things not seen. And then in all the other verses, after giving us the definition of faith, he gives us the description of faith. He gives us the demonstration of faith. And he gives us to the patriarchs, the pioneers, the prophets, and the people that lived by faith. And then he encourages us and he says, this is the way to live. Then he pictures the life of the people of God from earth to heaven. And as he pictures everything, he says, if we're going to get there, if we're going to reach there, all we need will be supplied by faith. And as you read from chapter 2, verse 1, chapter 2 of Hebrews, verse 1, he's telling us how important what we're studying is, how indispensable. That's why it says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. There are times that will come in our lives that the tendency will be to forget and to let them slip. All these things we're hearing about faith, the characteristics of faith, the continuity of faith, and the commencement of faith, the consummation of faith in our lives. When trials come, when temptations come, when difficulties come, when challenges come to our lives, the tendency is to soon look at our problems and look at our challenges, and then we forget all that we have been learning. And so the Word of God says, don't allow that to happen. In fact, it says, everything we hear, everything we learn, we benefit as we apply them by faith. And we live by faith, and we walk by faith, and we think in faith, and we plan in faith, and we do everything in faith. Other people have heard before us, and the Word did not profit them because it lacked faith, obedience, or faith with them. Looking at Hebrews chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 1. It says, let us therefore fear, lest a promise be left us of entering in, any of us should seem to come short of it. It says, that's the reason you need to take care, to watch and to take heed, because you can come short of the power and the demonstration of faith in your life. If you do not take it to the things you are hearing, look at verse 2, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them. Why? Not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. So it's not enough to just hear. The word must mix with faith in the hearts of the people that hear. Well, they learned quite a lot from Abraham as the Lord called him. And we talked about the call of God. He calls us to salvation. He calls us to sanctification. And he calls us to service. And we've seen the obedience of Abraham, which is an example for us, because we are to walk in the same steps of the faith of Abraham, that you obeyed the Lord promptly. You obeyed the Lord without questioning. You obeyed the Lord without dilly-dallying, without delaying. You obeyed the Lord without reasoning. Why should I do that? Why shouldn't I do that? You obeyed the Lord without even knowing where he will get to. Because the Bible says when the Lord calls him, he obeyed, not knowing whither he went. And the Lord is telling us to follow the same example of the faith of Abraham, of the faith of the people we have learnt about in the Bible. Look at Hebrews chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12, that ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Through faith and patience, that's what patience there is, actually perseverance. They persevered, they endured, and they said the word the Lord has spoken. And because the Lord has spoken, we are going to follow that word. We're going to be obedient to that word. That's what brings us to the study of today, perseverance of faith. The perseverance of faith. They persevered until the very end. Look at something in verse 13 of that Hebrews chapter 11. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the promises. That confuses a lot of people, that these people believed and yet it says they did not receive the promises. Now, what you need to understand is that the promises of God were in various categories. There were promises that were for the present time. Those promises for the present time, of course, they received that. They got the benefit of that. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all his benefit. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Look at this. Who healeth all thy diseases, who forgiveth all thine iniquities. The promise of forgiveness they received. The promise of salvation they received. And the promise of provision they received. And the promise of taking care of them and healing their body. All that they received. What does this mean then? When it says, these all died in faith, not having received the promises. There were some promises that were made for them that were for the future. Those ones for the future, they were to be fulfilled later. But they died in faith. They believed that even after their death, even after their passing on, those promises will still be yes and amen. They will still be fulfilled. They were not losing hope, because the Lord had told them, he told them some of those promises are for the future. When he says, you'll be a blessing to all the families of the earth. That was a great promise. It was not fulfilled at the time of Abraham, because Christ had to come. Because it is through Christ, the seed of Abraham, that will eventually be fulfilled. I will give you all the land, from the place you see from here, unto River Euphrates and all the other places, I'm going to give you. All that was not fulfilled at the time of Abraham, but he knew it was coming, that God will fulfill what he had said. That's why it says, they kept on believing until the point of death. They kept on believing until they passed from here to the other side, knowing that God will not fail. The same thing with us today. As we look at all the promises that the Lord has made, he's giving us a lot of promises that, number one, they are for the present life. Salvation for the present life. Holiness for the present life. Holy Ghost baptism, that's for the present life. And success and health and healing and cure, the breaking of every yoke, that's for the present life. But you know, there's another promise he has given us. He says, those who believe in him, that even if they die, they will rise again. That's for the future. And we keep on believing that, knowing that that day will come on the resurrection morning when we hear the voice of the Lord, and the dead who hear the voice of the Lord will rise up. It will happen. I said it will happen. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all die. We shall not all sleep. But in the twinkling of an eye, the trumpet shall sound. And then we shall be changed. That's the rapture. It's not happened yet. Even if we die, we keep on believing until we die. And we know that on that final day, when the timetable of God reaches that point, it will happen. It will happen in Jesus' name. And so there are promises we receive now. Their promises will wait until the time of its fulfillment. And so that's why you have what we have there. But we need to explain so that we persevere in faith. We continue in faith until everything the Lord has promised, everything will be done in Jesus' name. As we look at the study today, perseverance in faith, we're going to look at 3 points. Number one, the constancy of faith. The constancy of faith. That means you believe now, you keep on believing, you keep on believing every moment of your life, every turn of the way, every challenge that may come. You rely on the Lord every time. You get saved by faith, you get sanctified by faith, you get healed by faith, you get delivered by faith, you overcome temptation by faith. Every moment you keep on believing, the constancy of faith. Point number two is the commitment of faith. Faith is not something you just say, okay, faith is there, but you have to show that you are committed to God, you trust God, you love God, and you know that what He has said, if what you are going to live by, you have the commitment of faith. And then point number three will be the catalog of benefits through faith. The catalog of the benefits we have quite a lot. And I pray that everything the Lord has promised for the present time will be yours in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 11 verse 13, the constancy of faith. Hebrews 11, I'm reading from verse 13, says, "These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth." In verse 14, "For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country." As you look at that verse 13, it says they all died in faith, not having received the promises. What does that mean again? They died in faith. That is, even though they had not seen the fulfillment, there was no shadow of doubt in their minds. They knew it was going to be, and it will be. Look at Genesis chapter 50, verse 24. Genesis chapter 50. And we're looking at verse 24. We're reading about Joseph here. Joseph was about to die, but he gave instruction to the children of Israel. And from the instruction he gave them, you will see he was going to die, but he was going to die not in unbelief, not in shaking faith, not in discouraged, drooping mind, not in hopelessness. Died in faith. Look at verse 24. Joseph said unto his brethren, "I die." And he didn't say that as sorrowful. He didn't say that as if it's unfortunate I'm dying. No, he was an old man. And he was saying this excitedly. I'm going. Abraham is gone. Isaac is gone. Jacob is gone. And they've gone to the right hand side. And they've gone to that place. I'm going to be with them too. And then he says, "And God will surely visit you." That's the expression of his faith. God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land unto the land which is where to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob. That's how they died in faith. It had not been fulfilled, but he knew it will eventually be fulfilled. That's why he said, "I'm so sure the Lord will visit you." Why was he so sure? The present promises that God gave him had been fulfilled. He had a dream, and his brethren came to bow down to him. Those people did not believe, but he believed. And he said, since the promises made to me of the present life, since they are all fulfilled, I know the one of the future will still be fulfilled. And that is the way you receive your life. He promised to save me. I repented, he saved me. That's the present promise. The one that has not been done in the future, he'll do that to you. He promised to make me holy, sanctify me, purify me. And I prayed, I consecrated myself to the Lord. He's done that. That's the promise for the present time. If he has done the one for the present, he will do the one for the future. As he baptized you in the Holy Ghost with the speaking in tongues and with the power to witness in your life, if he has done this, he's going to do the other one. And so that helps you to then concentrate and have your confidence in God that he has done that in the past, he will do the other one in the future too. But you know, these people, they actually knew the promises of God. The Lord did not tell them that everything was going to be fulfilled just like that. He gave them, he said, this will be for the future. That's why they could die in faith, knowing it will be done. Genesis chapter 15. In Genesis chapter 15, here the Lord himself was going to promise something to Abraham. And see what he told Abraham in Genesis chapter 15. He said, look at verse 5, and he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. He had no child at this time. And God said, this is how your descendants will be. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it unto him for righteousness. And he said unto him, I am the Lord that brought thee out of the Ur of the Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it. He said, I'm giving you this land to inherit this land. But look at what God said now in verse 15. And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace. God was saying, Abraham, you will die, and thou shalt be buried in a good old age. But in the fourth generation, they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. That is, this is for the future. It's in the first generation that your descendants will come to occupy this land. And so Abraham knew. He knew the promises for the present time. He knew the promises for the future. And he knew that even though they were not done, they were not fulfilled in his lifetime, eventually they were going to be fulfilled. Come back to Hebrews chapter 11 verse 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises. Not having received the promises for the future. The promises are to be fulfilled at a later time. And then it goes on to say, but having seen them afar off, and persuaded, they were persuaded of them and embraced them. They saw the fulfillment of those promises in the future. And he said, I know that God will do that. That's what he has said. And he cannot fail. He will do it. He has done the one of the present life. He's going to do the one of the future. I want you to keep that in your mind every time. Because a lot of promises await us. He reserves inheritance for us in heaven. That's future. He says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If you were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. It's for the future. And then he said, you'll wear a crown. You'll be rewarded over there. That's for the future. And those ones will not be done here on earth. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. It's for the future. But you know that God is a faithful God because he's doing the one for the present time. And then you say, I know that if he could do the one for the present time, and it's not late and cannot fail, cannot falter, then I know he's going to do the one in the future. But look at that verse 13, the latter part, and they confess that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. They had the attitude that they were strangers and pilgrims. And that is what the Lord wants us to have in our mind. That while you are going through this life, you are not to settle down here as if this is your final home. He said, God is preparing a place for me in heaven. I'm actually going to that place. And over here on earth, we're just strangers and pilgrims. Come to 1 Peter chapter 2, 1 Peter chapter 2, and you'll see what the Lord calls every believer to. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, dearly beloved, I beseech you, as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. It says, we shall be conscious every time that that is who we are. It says, we must live as strangers and pilgrims on this earth. What does that mean? Number one, as strangers, it means that we're citizens of heaven. We follow the laws of heaven. We follow the order of heaven. And we follow instructions from heaven. You must be conscious of that every time. In your office, in your community, even in your family, if they are not all Christians, you understand you are different. Because you are a stranger here. And as a stranger here, you have another country. God has prepared another kingdom. I will be there. Then there's no turning back. There's no turning back. The world behind you and the cross before you. No turning back. No turning back. Oh, not only that, it means that you are separated from the corruption of the present evil world. Because you're not of this world. You're a stranger here. And you're not part of the system. The people who are part of the system, they can practice their corruption. They can practice their idolatry. They can practice their abominations. They can practice their worldliness. They may practice all their customs, all their traditions. And you will not be part of them. Why? Because you're a stranger. You're a foreigner over here. You're not really part of them. What does it mean that you are a stranger here? It means that you speak a different language. And you have a different focus. And you have a different destiny. You're going a different direction. You must always be conscious of that. If you say you are born again, if you say you are a child of God, you're a stranger here. Your language will be different. Your appearance will be different. Your dressing will be different. Your outlook, everything, your plan will be different. Cousin is doing this. If cousin is not born again, you cannot do that. And papa is doing this. If papa is not born again, you cannot do that. They are offering chieftaincy title. That's for them. That's not for you. Because you are a stranger here. There are things they do. There are things they say. There are places they go. There are things they drink. There are things they smoke that you cannot have any part in because you are a stranger. Here. Have you known that we don't generally understand strangers because their customs are different. They are strangers. Their lifestyle is different. They are strangers. Their worldview is different. They are strangers. The same thing, if you are not of this world, but Christ has chosen you to be out of this world and you are a stranger here, they will not understand you. My mom might come and say, my daughter, I don't understand you nowadays. I used to understand you. Everything, you know, if I told to pick that, you pick it, do this, and you do that, wear this, you wear that. But nowadays, I can't understand you because you become a stranger to her. And papa might say, my boy, I don't understand you again. Because, you know, I tell you this, sacrifice, I tell you do this, you don't do it anymore. I don't understand you. We do not understand strangers. If the world understands every step you take, everything you do, everywhere you go, every move you make, then you are not a stranger to the world. Then you are part of them. You will not be part of them. I said you will not be part of them. And you know, sometimes we don't always appreciate strangers. Sometimes somebody comes, it just comes from another country. And it's not dressing the normal way, what you will call the normal way. The way he puts his headgear or whatever is so different. And then you are saying, why about this? You don't appreciate that because it's not of your country. It's not of your community. It's coming from another place. The same thing as a child of God. They may not appreciate you. You see, there are people, they do not understand. I'm a stranger here. I'm born again. My citizenship is in heaven, and I'm going to heaven. And then when your family people call you and they say, you know, we need to tell you directly, we don't appreciate you, then you feel ashamed. But you should feel happy. This shows that now they don't appreciate my life. They don't appreciate my steps. They don't appreciate the way I'm going and the way I do things. And I know I'm following the word of God. They do not understand that word of God. You are a stranger to them. because we belong to another kingdom, another world. We may not always appreciate strangers, but they know what they are doing, because they know where they're coming from, and they do not observe our own custom. They do not observe the things that we do, and you must have that concept in your mind as well. And sometimes strangers are homesick. Strangers are homesick. They're thinking of their home. And many times we sing about heaven. Some of the songs nowadays, the contemporary songs, they don't sing about heaven, because those writers of the songs, maybe they did not really understand where we're going. They do not understand that we're homesick and want to go to heaven. And then as you look at the old songbooks, they sang about heaven a lot. My home, New Jerusalem. What a joy it will be when I get home. And what a joy it should be. Should we die without any pain and without any sickness and we'll just go home like that? Glory it will be. What glory it will be. You see, the old songs, they tell us that we're going to heaven. But the Christians of nowadays, those who are wishy-washy in their Christian experiences, because they do not understand, we're strangers here. They only sing about feel happy here, feel joyful here, and all that. But I pray that God will help us to come back to the consciousness, we're strangers here. I said we're strangers here. And you will act like that. You behave like that. You live like that. You think like that. And your mind will be filled with the things of your destination. But not only that, we're strangers, we're also pilgrims. Who are pilgrims? Pilgrims are the people going on a journey. We're traveling from here and we're traveling to heaven. And because we're on a journey, if you have ever been on an important journey, we take only the basic necessities. We don't overload ourselves with baggages and this and that. Only the necessities. That's why Christians are moderate in all things. And the Lord said, the Lord is at hand. Let your moderation be known unto all men. Be like a pilgrim. Be like a person that doesn't want to have all these extra loads, all these things that are not necessary. And a person who is a pilgrim does not settle by the side of the road. He doesn't just sit down there. You remember the young prophet? The young prophet went to the place the Lord told him to go, and he said, go back home now. Don't stay by the way. Stand by the way. Sit by the way. And the man just sat down there until the old prophet came and caught him. And then brought him back. Eventually he was killed by a lion. I pray that you will not be killed by the wayside. You will not stop your journey halfway. There are people that, you know, they just, I'm tired now. And living for God, I'm tired now. Evangelism, I am tired now. Prayer meeting, I'm tired now. Bible study, I'm tired now. Come to the worship service, I am tired now. But you're not at home yet. Don't settle down. Keep on moving. All these so-called little things, they matter a lot. That your heart, your mind is still away. And you know that you are a pilgrim and you're going on a journey. Not only that, if you are really going on a journey, you feel your mind on your destination. Fix your mind on your destination. If you have been in the public transport before, you are in the bus, and then middle of the way, some people are jumping down and they're going away, and they say that's the way they want to go. You don't say, because so-and-so has come down, so-and-so has come down from the bus, you also come down from the bus. You know where you are going. You have your destination. The same thing as to become a Christian. You are a pilgrim. You are on a journey, and you are going to heaven. Until you reach heaven, you will not stop. I said you will not stop. You might find other people, they're jumping down. I want to get down here. It's enough for me now. Have you reached home? Not yet, but I think I want to get down. The Christian life is boring to them. They cannot continue. And they come down before reaching their destination. I will reach my destination. I said I will reach my destination. You don't look at other people who are getting down, who are going back, because you are a pilgrim, and then also you do not follow the examples of other people. You just know that you are going to continue to the very end, and you are thinking of where the home will be. And when you are getting nearer and nearer, you are happy, you are joyful. You find some people who say they are Christians, and they are getting nearer and nearer heaven, because they are getting older and older. And then if they are sick at all, they want to, God heal me, God heal me, God heal me, instead of preparing and saying, I don't know, I'm, you know, the way things are happening in the body now, maybe this will be the last sickness before I cross over to the other side. And then you pack your load very well, and you examine yourself very well, and say, should this be the last sickness before I go to the other side? Help me, let me get ready, so that I can move to the other side. But there are people that are so much on healing that they forget salvation. They forget a clear conscience. They forget purity of heart. They forget, without holiness no man shall see the Lord. Once there's a little sickness like this, and they're old, and instead of examining themselves and saying, I don't know what last sickness will come before I cross over to the other side, let me make sure, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Let me make sure, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Let me re-examine myself again. Who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who shall dwell in your holy place? They that have clean hands and a pure heart, they are not thinking of that. Only God heal me, God heal me. Yes, God can heal you. But what if God does not heal you? Because think about Abraham. That's the last sickness he had before he went on. Think about Isaac. That's the last sickness he had before he passed on. And so when you are sick, even if you are not old, you should still think about that. This may be the last sickness before I pass on. While you are praying for healing on the one side, you are praying, oh Lord, should this be the last sickness? Help me to get ready. Help me to get ready. Help me to get ready. You'll be ready in Jesus' name. Or are you afraid to go home? You think of a person that is outside and will say, where is your home? Where is your house? My house is over there. It's getting late. It's getting dark. Why don't you get up and go home? I'm afraid. There are some Christians like that. They're afraid to go home. But it's getting dark, and the time is about over. I will soon hear the trumpet sound, and the Lord will call us and say, children, that's enough. Come back home. Come back home. And when that time arrives, I pray you'll be there in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 11, and I'm reading from verse 13. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 13. It says in verse 13, these all died in faith. Don't die in unbelief. Don't die doubting. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. They seek a country. And that's what the Lord wants us to do. Let's have that mind. We're seeking the country. We're looking at Colossians chapter 1, chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, and I'm reading here from verse 1. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Be like Abraham. Be like those patriarchs of old, that you say you are born again. You say you have been crucified with Christ. You have died with Christ. You are buried with Christ. And you have risen with Christ. It says then, if ye be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Do you seek the things above more than the things on earth? You know, as we look at the lives of Christians in quotes, the way they seek after the things on earth, the way they seek after, let me, be strong, let me be healthy, let me be, you know, beautiful, charming and all that, and they buy this and buy that and buy that. They will do anything to keep healthy. They'll do anything to look fit and to look smart. And it's like everything in their lives, there are some people, their major thing is exercise. They're jogging, they're trotting, they're running, they're doing the treadmill, they're doing this and that. And why are you doing all this? You spend so many hours every day. I have to do that to keep fit. Those are things on earth. It's good for you, it's good for everybody, but the things that are spiritual, the things above, that you will take care of things above. People think about what they eat, and then they choose this and choose this and choose this. We say, why are you taking all this trouble? Well, you know, to keep fit now, you have to have balanced diet, you have to do this and that. Do you have balanced diet of scripture, of the spiritual? Do you think of things above more than things on earth? We should change things, and we should put focus and put emphasis on spiritual things, that the time you spend, the thoughts you have, and the thinking, everything, we should divert it through spiritual things. If you are risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ seated on the right hand of God. There are people that will, for the education of the children, they will send their children anywhere, and they send them to America, to Canada, to China, to Hong Kong, to Singapore, and to England, everywhere. They will spend the last penny that they have, because this, my child, must have education. Are we so serious about this? My child must have salvation. This, my child, must get to heaven. That the way we're making effort and the way we're spending everything for the child to get education, are we spending the same effort, making the same effort to make sure that these children, they have salvation? Don't you want your children to get to heaven? And don't you know, except a man, except a boy, except a girl be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God? And then even we ourselves, the way you wake up early in the morning without quiet time, the way you wake up early in the morning and pursuing this and pursuing this, and all this during this covenant month, all that we're asking for, Lord, progress, remember me. Lord, promotion, remember me. Lord, it's a job, remember me. Lord, remember me. I need a wife, I need husband, I need children. Are you so serious about these things that are passing away and the things that are really necessary, very important, indispensable? You're not thinking about them. But to see all those patriarchs of old, the people of old, what they were seeking after was spiritual thing. They were seeking a country, an heavenly country, a better country. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ seated on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. It's direct. It's very clear. Set your mind, set your purpose, set your desire, set your plans on things above, not on things on the earth. The people that will almost die because of the things of this world. Now, we know that, you know, having a good country is very important. And I know there are some highly placed people listening to the Bible study. But, you know, we still have to put the emphasis where the emphasis should be. There are people that will almost die for politics. There are people for position, they will die. It may be political position, religious position, church position. There are people that this is what they want. My goal is that I must have this. I must have this. How about salvation? Are we going to struggle and struggle for political position, religious position, academic position, professional position, and lose heaven? Turn around and put the emphasis where the emphasis ought to be. That's what those patriarchs did. That's why we're reading about them now, that their mind was about heaven. They were seeking for that better country. See, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth, for ye are dead. What does that mean? You are dead to the things of the world. You hold them with loose hand. If they come, praise the Lord. If they don't come, praise the Lord. If God knows that that is good enough for me and he gives me, praise the Lord. But I'm going to subject it to my control. I'm going to put it on control. I'm not going to allow it to master my mind, control my mind, direct my mind, oppress my mind. As if that is it, I must keep that. Even if I lose salvation, God forbid. I said, God forbid. And so for you too, whatever it is you have here on earth, I would even say in the church. You know, church position does not take us to heaven. Do you know that? I said, do you know that? And there are people that will fight for church position. I must be this, I must be this, I must... You can be that and miss heaven. We came to this church not because of, you know, position, religious position or this or that. We came so that, show me the way to heaven. Show me the way to glory land. Show me how to be born again and show me how to keep saved and show me how to be sanctified. Show me, if tell me about this holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. That was why you came. Many of us have been in other churches before you came here. It was because you heard about this holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. That's why you stayed. Why are you changing? Why is it that other things are more important to you? Did you know about being a pastor when you came here? You didn't know that. Did you know about being overseer when you came here? You didn't know that. Did you know about being a full-time worker before you came? You didn't know that. All you wanted, I want heaven. They're teaching the Bible in that place. And if I follow that thing they're teaching, it will take me to heaven. That's why you came. Remain in that conviction. You remain in Jesus' name. If I, by the grace of God, could remain in that same conviction after being born again for more than 50 years now, and I know that preaching does not take me to heaven. I know that running up and down, run around a lot does not take me to heaven. I know that doing this or doing that does not take me to heaven. I know that that inward transparent holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, is what will take me there by his grace. And therefore I balance up everything. And I'm calling upon you, balance up your life. I said, balance up your life. And whatever, any position, anything that, you know, anybody is going to struggle and it will make you do something unchristianly and then you lose what you have, you say, please take the world and give me Jesus. Take all those things. You can take them away. Let me have what will take me to heaven. That's how to set your affection on things above and not on things on earth. You are dead to them and your life is sealed with Christ in God. And then it says, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. I pray you'll be there in Jesus' name. Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. I'm reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 13. We're reading from verse 12. Wherefore, Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people. It's Jesus who sanctifies. He makes holy. That's to prepare us for heaven. Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood suffered without the gate. Let us go forth therefore unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. Why? Why do we get sanctified? Why are we so serious about this holiness? Why is it we're mentioning it over and over? This year in particular, look at this, for here, because here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. We seek one to come. I pray you'll get there. Look at Micah chapter 2. Micah chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 10. Micah chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 10. Micah 2, reading from verse 10. It says in verse 10, arise ye, depart. Arise ye, depart, for this is not your rest. Look around you. The corruption in that office, the evil in that community, the idolatry in that village, and the tradition, abominable tradition, where you live. And you have the tendency, if you cannot beat them, join them. And you are forgetting that you are strangers and pilgrims here on earth. You are forgetting that all these promises of earthly things, they are nothing. Even if you gain the whole world, if you lost your soul, you'll be of all men the most miserable. That's why it says, arise ye and depart. For this is not your rest, because it is polluted. It shall destroy you, even with a sore destruction. The Lord is calling us to get out of every form of corruption and to seek heavenly things. and then that heaven will get there in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number two now, the commitment of faith. The commitment of faith. It tells us in verse 15, of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 15. It says, and truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. What the Bible is telling us here is that all those patriarchs, all those prophets, all those people, all those men and women, if they were thinking about where they came out from, like the magnet attracting them back, like those children of Israel, the mixed multitude in the wilderness, if they were thinking of Egypt every time, and the useless things in Egypt, the little insignificant things in Egypt, the redundant things in Egypt, the things you should just bring under your feet or throw at your back in Egypt. Do you think about that? Onion and cucumber and the garlic and the fish and the things we used to eat in Egypt. Can you think about that? Turning somebody's mind away from the land of Canaan. Turning somebody's mind away from the inheritance that the Lord wants to give us. And there are people like that today, you know. There are people that are thinking of inconsequential things. Little things. And those little things, insignificant things, are so important to them. And their minds are going back to the world. If I wasn't a Christian, if I wasn't a member of this church, if I didn't hear about all these teachings, if I didn't get exposed to all this holiness and everything, what I could be doing now, how I could be dressing now, what I could be putting on now. And in their mind, it's like they are back to the world. You see, if you are thinking like that, you soon go back. The devil knows what you are thinking about. He knows what is attracting you. He knows what you are deliberating, what you are arguing about in your heart. The word of God, there's no small part of the word of God. The Lord has given us his word so that by grace we follow that word and we get to heaven. The final thing is to get to heaven. Whatever you are here, maybe you are, you know, you are happy, you are whatever, excited. Happiness and excitement is not enough. I do this and that pleases me. I do this, I feel all right. It's not how you feel. What does the word of God say? Because if you have the mind as if you want to go back, eventually it says, if they had been mindful of the country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. In the case of Abraham, he was going to choose a wife for the son, Isaac. And the servant said, what if the lady will not come? Can I take your son there? He said, never. Don't take my son there. We'll say bye-bye. We'll say goodnight. We'll say, we're not coming back there again. We will not go back there again. We have said bye-bye to the world. We'll not go back there again in Jesus' name. By the way, you heard the Bible reading that we had just before the message. And you see, it says, this is abomination to the Lord. This is abomination. That's abomination to the Lord. Abominations are still abominations to the Lord. God does not change. Whatever God writes, whether he writes it on the left part of the Bible, Old Testament, or the right part of the Bible, New Testament, abomination is still abomination. And you will not say, because now I'm saved by grace, and then go and do all those abominable things that we read about in that Bible reading. In fact, it says, all the other countries, all the other nations, the Lord judged them. They were not Israelites. They were not people that God had even spoken to. He said, because they did those abominable things, that the Lord spewed them out. So if we come now and we say, okay, nothing matters anymore, just live anyhow, do anything anyhow, the land, the kingdom will spill you out. Because you're going back to those abominable things. You'll not go back in Jesus' name. It says, but now in verse 16, but now the desire, a better country, that is an heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. He has prepared for them a city. I will be there. I said, I will be there. look at 1 John chapter 2 verse 28, so that if he's not going to be ashamed of us, and we are not going to be ashamed on that final day, 1 John chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 28, it says in verse 28, and now, little children, abide in him. You want to get to heaven? Abide in him. Don't think about the world you came out from. Abide in him. Don't go back to Egypt. Abide in him. Don't sing the songs of Egypt. It will bring Egypt back to your mind. Abide in him. Don't keep the pictures of Egypt. It will bring Egypt back to your mind. Abide in him. Don't begin to say, don't begin to tell yourself or tell other people, when I was in the world, when I was in the world. Why are you talking about that? When I was in the world, I used to do this, I used to do this, I used to do that. Your mind will go back. And it says, if they had been mindful to go back to the country from which they came, they would have got opportunity to have returned. But now they said, they blocked everything of the past out of their mind. They were going to the land of promise. And to the land of promise they came. I will get there. I said, I will get there. It says, little children, abide in him. Then it says that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. It means you will not look back. I said, it means you will not look back. And let's look at Genesis chapter 19. Genesis chapter 19. Here is what the angels told Lot and his family. What a wonderful thing if they had obeyed, if they had all obeyed. It says in Genesis chapter 19 verse 17, and it came to pass when they had brought them forth abroad, is that he said, escape for thy life. Look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. It says, look not behind thee. Lot was there. The wife of Lot was there. And the two daughters were there. And all the four, they heard the voice of the angel. And look at verse 26. It says in verse 26, and his wife did what? Look back from behind him. It says from behind him. You know, the people that want to look back, they first of all begin to draw back, so that they are not following the same pace as we are following. Sister, what's happening? Buck up now. Hurry up. Let's be walking together. You look too fast for me. Go on. I will meet up. And from behind him, her mind was thinking about the world. Her mind was thinking about Sodom and Gomorrah. Her mind was thinking about all we invested in Sodom, all the servants there, all the sheep there. What made them to separate from Abraham was their possession. And now the possession was going to go up in flames in Sodom. And so from behind him, she looked back. You know, there are some husbands, they love their wives so much that if the wife said, honey, you know what? This is too much now. I think I'll prefer to go back to, we'll still be going to church, but we can go to church. You know where we're coming from? Where we used to beat drum and everybody and things like that. I think I prefer that. There's some husband who'll say, my wife, okay, if you say we should go, we're going back. Are you going to go back with her? Others, it's like, you know, the husband is saying, you know, honey, we're losing contract. As you'll not give bride, you'll not do this, you'll not do this. You know, I know where would have been if I could just give a little tip, a little bribe. And then the husband and the wife said, don't do that. You know, according to the, don't preach Bible now, don't preach to me. It's like, you know, I want to make it. When I make it, then I will come back. Those who have gone like that, they never come back. They never come back. And some wives was okay, my husband, I love you so much, if you are going back to the old place, I will go with you. I will not go with anybody. I said I will not go with anybody. Children, you make up your mind. Parents, you make up your mind. Because it says over here, she looked back from behind him and she became a pillar of salt. What did Jesus say about that? Look at Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 17. Only open your Bible. Open your Bible. We came here to study the word of God. In Luke chapter 17 verse 32. Here are the words of Jesus Christ. Remember Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife. I remember Lot's wife, I will not go back. I said, I will not go back. Brothers and sisters, you must be a man of your mind, a woman of your mind. That you know that this is what the Bible teaches. This is the way that leads to heaven. And even if you are going to suffer persecution, you say, it's better to suffer little persecution here than to go to hell and be there forever and ever, burning in the lake of fire. I pray it will not happen to you. That's why you make up your mind here. And it says, remember, Lord's what? John chapter 6. In John chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 66. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? Will ye also go away? Look at verse 16. Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the word of eternal life. And we believe that and assure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. That way, what you have chosen, I pray nobody will take it away from you. Luke chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 42. Luke chapter 10, verse 42. But one thing is needful, and Mary has chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. Mary has chosen that good part. What's your name? Put your name there. I have chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from me. Will not be taken away from you in Jesus' name. Psalm 112, Psalm 112. Watch your relationships with people. Watch your friendships. If you are so friendly with somebody that, you know, little by little, changing you and turning your mind away from the word of God, watch it. Can make you to become Lord's wife. Can make you to become a demons, loving this present world. And then going away from the Lord. In Psalm 112, verse 7, he shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. You fix your heart. You fix your mind. Whatever others do, you are going to stand for righteousness all the days of your life. In Proverbs chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 21. Proverbs chapter 24, verse 21. My son, fear thou the Lord and the King, and meddle not with them that are given to change. Don't be friendly with people that are given to change. The people that say repentance is no more important, restitution is no more important, they do anything or whatever, say, ah, you're a believer. You're taking that thing that doesn't belong. Oh, don't worry about that. How about restitution? Restitution? Don't worry about that. I used to believe that. I used to think like that. Those people, they're giving to change. Meddle not with them that are giving to change. Where are you coming from? At 11:30, I went to visit Sister So-and-so. Sister So-and-so is single lady. You went to visit her at 11:30. Are you not afraid that, you know, temptation might come? You might get involved in this. Okay, and what is that? The grace of God. You were not like that before. Sit up and do the will of God. And remember that holiness is practical. It's not just that we're preaching it. Live it out. And it says you should not meddle with them that are giving to change. The people that are lowering the standards. And they're muddling up everything. And they cannot live a straight life that we know that that is a Christian. That's a real child of God. It says, meddle not with them. Relate not. Be friendly not. Fellowship not with them that are giving to change. We're going to stand by the word of God in Jesus' name. If you're still there, give me a good amen. Amen. Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 18. Galatians chapter 2. Reading from verse 18. Here it tells us in verse 18, Galatians chapter 2. It says, for if I build again the things which I once destroyed, I make myself what? A transgressor. There are some people, as they are getting older in the Christian faith, they begin to tone down, as if what they believed before 20 years ago, as if that was not the right doctrine. As if what they said 30 years ago, as if that was not the right thing. They say, now you know, we're getting older, we're mild, we're mellowed down. That means you want to change the word of God. That the standard is not the same standard anymore. That righteousness is not necessary anymore. Holiness is not necessary anymore. Sanctification is not true anymore. Because you are now, you know, I'm now of age. What do you mean of age? Being of age changes the Bible. Tell me. No. If I build again what I once destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. I pray you will stand. You will stand for the truth and you'll not go back to any evil sin, any sinful sin in Jesus' name. Hebrews chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 38. Now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. If any man draw back, if any woman draws back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. We're coming to point number three now, the catalog of benefits through faith in Christ. In Hebrews chapter 11, we're reading verse 11. Hebrews chapter 11, we're looking at the word receive, because it says in verse 13, these all died in faith, having not having received the promise. Not having received the promise. And people misunderstand that and they say, you know, you can be believing God for salvation and have faith for salvation and not receive. No, that's not what it means. Other people say, you may have faith and faith and faith for sanctification and not receive. That's not what it says. Other people say, I believe in being baptized in the Holy Ghost. But I've read it says, they all died in faith, not having received the promises. No, I've explained to you what it means is this. There were promises for the present life. Salvation, sanctification, Holy Ghost baptism, healing, deliverance, protection, preservation. All those promises are for today. And the promises unto you, and to your children, and to them that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. All those promises are here and for now. But the promises for the future, that's the one he's saying, they all died in faith, not having received, because it wasn't time yet. And let's look at verse 11 and see that, the one you could receive. It says through faith also, Sarah received strength. Sarah received strength to conceive. You see, there were barren people in the Bible like Anna. She received faith. She had faith to receive a miracle child. Elizabeth had faith to receive the miracle child, and many other women too. And so if that's the situation today, as you believe, it will be unto you according to your faith in Jesus' name. Now, you also look at verse 17. In verse 13, 17, you say, by faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises. You see here now, these are promises he had received. God promised him a child in his soul, and he received. He promised him other things too, and he received. It's only the future ones that he didn't receive until he died. And the Lord had told him it will take the fourth generation before they will receive that. But this one now, he received the promises and offered up his only begotten son. And so everything the Lord has promised us, we're going to have in Jesus' name. We're coming to the last two verses. That is verses 39 and 40. It says, and these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. They received not the promise of the Messiah. Isaiah prophesied, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulder. And Isaiah died and didn't see the fulfillment of that promise. But the promise came at the right time. In due time, Christ came and was born and he died for us. At his own time, it was future. And that's the reason why it didn't happen at that time. Daniel received the vision and the promise of the 70 weeks of Daniel. And it talks about when Christ was sacrificed for, will be sacrificed for our sin. Daniel died and that thing had not been fulfilled at that time. It is not fulfilled. And also prophecy of Daniel spoke about the time of the great tribulation. And that has not happened yet. And Daniel has already died. And that has not been done. Because that's for the future. But the things for the present time is for the present time and will be fulfilled in Jesus' name. It says in verse 40, God having provided some better thing for us, that without us they should not be made perfect. That's why they had not received at that time. The church needs to come in so that they will now, the church will now receive the rest and then they will be perfected. But think about what the Old Testament people had. Number one, they had peace with God. Because they promised them and they had it, the peace that is a deep like the sea, like the ocean. They had pardon. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man is lost, and let him return unto the Lord. For he will abundantly pardon the whole of Nineveh, the whole city, thousands of people. They were pardoned. They received the promise, the purity of heart. They received that promise. In fact, Ezekiel said, oh Lord, look at me. I have a perfect heart. I followed and walk with a perfect heart, and the Lord answered his prayer. They had pure hearts, they had sanctification, they had holiness, and they had a perfect heart that made them to be able to get whatever they wanted from the Lord. They had the power of the Spirit. Look at Micah chapter 3. Micah, they were not baptized in the Holy Ghost, but they had the power of the Spirit in their lives. In Micah chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 8. So you will not say, well, they didn't receive. They had a lot of things. They had peace with God. They had pardon for their sins. They had purity of heart. And they had holiness and sanctification. And they had the power of the Holy Ghost to do what the Lord wanted them to do at their own time, in their own generation. And you can have it today. You'll have it in Jesus' name. Micah chapter 3, I'm looking at verse 8. It says, truly, but truly, I am full of power by the Spirit of the Lord, and of judgment and of might to declare unto Jacob his transgressions, and to Israel his sin. That's an Old Testament person. They had the power of God, the power of the Spirit. We're looking at 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, and I'm reading from verse 21. 2 Peter chapter 1. We're looking at verse 21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God. Old Testament people, holy men of God spake as they were moved, directed, and stirred up by the Holy Ghost. Those are the Old Testament people, and they had that. You remember Elisha saying unto Elijah, I need, give me a double portion of thy Spirit. They had the power of the Spirit, and then a double portion. They had the gifts of the Spirit. If you read 2 Kings chapter 6, you will see that they had the gifts of the Spirit. Revelation, word of knowledge, word of wisdom, and the discerning of spirit. Elisha had all that, and the gift of working miracle, and the gift of healing, and the gift of faith. Elisha had all that. And if they could have that, this is your day. You can have everything the Lord has promised you to have in Jesus' name. It says, in the last days I'll pour my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters, your visions, and your old men will dream dreams. And then it says in Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, verse 38, verse 39, it says, then Peter said unto them, repent, and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission, removal, forgiveness of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You see that? It's available today. This one is not for the future. This one is for the present hour. You can have grace to be saved and grace to be sanctified, and you have the promise of God to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. You can have strength. You can have the power to resist the devil and to be an overcomer. You can be more than a conqueror even at this very time. You can have protection. You can even have long life. Everything the Lord has promised and said, it is for the present hour, those promises are yours. I said those promises are yours. And then if you will not compromise your stand, if you know that this is mine and I will have it, whether other people have or not, whether they pray or not, that's not my problem. I am going to pray. I am going to have this. You will have it. Look at verse 39, for the promise is unto you. The promise is unto you. Is it for healing? The promise is unto you. Is it for deliverance? The promise is unto you. Is it for living above sin? A life that has authority and dominion, and sin shall not have dominion over you, the promise is unto you. Is it for a purified heart, a sanctified heart, a holy heart, and that you are living a life like Enoch lived, and you walk with God, and God took him away, a rapturable life, rapture-ready life? The Lord is able today, because it says, the promise is unto you. Power to witness, and power to pray effectually and effectively, the promise is unto you. And to your children, and to them that are far off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. The Lord is calling you. I said he's calling you. He's going to come and receive the promise to benefit from everything he has for us today. And whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be sanctified. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be filled and energized, empowered, enveloped by the Holy Ghost. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be healed. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. The promises are wide for the present day. And if you will just make your attention, make your heart to come to the word of God and say, that is mine, that is mine. I'm going to receive. Do you know you are going to receive? What do you need tonight? Salvation is available. Sanctification is available. Holy Ghost baptism is available. Healing is available. Deliverance is available. Triumph and victory, being an overcomer, having dominion, it's available. Having the power to witness, it's available. And having focused your life, that the Lord will so transform your life, you'll be thinking of things of heaven and not things of earth. It's available tonight. You can rise up and receive from the Lord and say, Lord, I must not go back home empty. If I'm saved, I need to be sanctified. If I'm saved and sanctified, I need to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. If I've got all that, if I'm sick, I need to get healed. I'll have healing. If I have all that, there's any yoke, there's any burden, all those yokes are going to be broken. All those things can be mine today. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer. The promise is unto you. The promise is unto you. The promise is available. Have you forgotten how to pray? Have you forgotten how to call on the name of the Lord? Have you forgotten how to set your mind, set your affection on things above and not on things on the earth? Have you forgotten how to lay hold of the hand of God and say, this is mine, and you will not let go? If you have tendency of backsliding, of looking back, tell the Lord, my heart is fixed. My heart is fixed, oh God. Let him fix your heart and focus your attention on things above, not on things on the earth. And be conscious about your destination. Conscious about going to heaven. Conscious about the greatest need of your life. And let the things of earth and the things of the flesh and the things of the body and the things of the present hour, the things of the present day, let them go to the background. All these overheated interest in the things of the world, in politics, in this, in that, in health and whatever it is, put that at the background and concentrate. Put first things first. First things first. First things first in your life, that you know that Christ is coming. I must be ready. I must be ready. Stop playing religion. Stop playing religion. And say, I know Christ may come at any time. I want to be ready. I want to be ready. I want to be ready. Don't allow the things of this world to tie you down. You're a stranger. You're a pilgrim. And you want to focus your attention on things that lead heavenward. Follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Lord, who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? Who will stand in your holy place? They that have clean hands, that's salvation, clean hands, that's living above sin, clean hands, no stealing, no adultery, no fornication, clean hands, no pornography, clean hands, no shedding of blood, clean hands. They that have clean hands, a clear conscience, and a pure heart, a holy heart, a righteous heart, a perfect heart, a heart that is totally, totally yielded to the Lord and cleansed and washed and purged and purified by the blood of the Lamb. You can be sanctified. You can be holy. You can be pure. The Lord can do it. Tell the Lord. Tell the Lord. You pray and say, Lord, I will have it. Don't play religion anymore. We don't know Christ may come this year. Let him meet you, rapture ready. Seek his face. Seek the better country. And say, Lord, I want to be there. I want to be there. I want to be there. I don't want false doctrine to keep me back. Carelessness to keep me back. Hypocrisy to keep me back. Little sins and over here, little drops of water make a mighty ocean. I don't want that to keep me back. You must be saved. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, cannot enter the kingdom of God. And you must be holy. You must be holy. You cannot play with holiness. You cannot joke with holiness. Without it, all religion is vain. Without it, all this up and down is for nothing. Don't let the rapture meet you unrighteous, unholy, not prepared. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near. Forsake everything you need to forsake. Lay everything on the altar and say, Lord, here am I. I want to be ready. He'll make you ready.